lots of us here have done these training days before, usually under the auspices of SAPRI. Well, always under the auspices of SAPRI. SAPRI is the Society for the Advancement of Philosophical, what is it, Rob? Inquiry and Reflection in Education. Can you ever remember that? SAPRI have been significant to PIPs in our development. Most of our inquiries follow a certain community of inquiry method, toned down a bit, which SAPRI use. There are lots of leaflets here from SAPRI leaflets and lots of leaflets that we develop from SAPRI. But the thing with SAPRI training, it tends to focus on schools, school children, educational institutions, which is a bit different from the open public arena that we operate in. So what we thought, so they don't cover that kind of thing. So what we thought we'd do is have our own training and cover and look at those areas that we've all experienced, talk about them, and maybe do a couple of inquiries today at some time and learn from that and further our practice ourselves as well. Okay. Oh, and also to hopefully enthuse anybody here who's thinking of opening a group to go ahead and do that. Okay, before we go into how best to do that, how best to start and run and organise a group, there's a prior question that we should all ask ourselves and hopefully answer, which is, why should we open a community philosophy group? Why philosophy? We know why what the original vision was and why me and Rob began this thing. But what we want to know here is your ideas of why we should want to open a philosophy group. Why philosophy?
I think, I'm not being pedantic or trying to be smart, the derivation of the word is actually literally love of knowledge, so just to foster knowledge in general, I would say.
Wisdom.
Yeah, it's different. And people can learn from what may seem the most trivial things, you know.
Can people see that? Okay.
Yeah.
Can I read pedantic again and say it's actually a lover of wisdom? Wisdom and knowledge are not the same thing.
Tulsi?
Another question is why philosophy, but I still think it fits in because I see it as enabling others. You know, it's in other places where it's not normally done. It's allowing them to do philosophy or allowing philosophy to be done wider venues, reaching more people, I think, not in its usual situation.
Grassroots community. Russell?
I think it's critical thinking. Which I think is very important in the sense that once people can think for themselves, it's very hard for them to take advantage of or to be swayed to join cults and things like that.
Okay, thanks.
I was at an inquiry and there was a question which I came out with an opinion more or less instinctively. And Rob there said, well, that's very abrupt. And then we went through the whole thing. And we ended up basically where we started from. But Rob taught me that, okay, now I can give reasons why I actually think that. So it's to be able to explain to myself and to other people. Thank you, it was very useful.
Good reasons for beliefs?
Yeah, beliefs or opinions.
Beliefs.
For me, it encourages tolerance towards other people and other people's thoughts, even if they differ from yours.
Stretch is fun.
It's
I spell tolerance wrong there, don't I?
I just want to say that I feel a bit fraudulent being here because I do a discussion in a country which we don't call philosophy, and it's open to the public, so I never know who's coming. So it's not a group of people rehearsing their own development so much as people have the opportunity to express their positions and then perhaps to enhance their capacity to influence. And all the other things that everybody else has said as well, you know, understanding and so on. But we don't call it philosophy. I hope I'm all right being here.
No.
Shall I go?
Yeah.
So, an opportunity to express themselves, as that Victoria.
And to express themselves, but to examine their own positions and therefore to have to justify those positions, as this gentleman said. And that's often people who've never spoken in a group before. So that brings different tensions.
Mark, all them off. Hey, Derek.
It's to know what the rubbish other people are thinking.
What you said before, you said stretch your mind.
I mean, there's a whole range of things other people think, and you find out the reasons why they do.
The privilege of thinking what other people think?
Yeah, I mean, other people's opinions and the reasons for why they do think that way. I think that's important.
Yeah.
Why is that in red?
Because the blacks.
I think one purpose that I think is important for me would be to resist and challenge the soundbite culture.
Yeah. Pick things to pieces. Yeah.
The news in 60 seconds.
Favourites of mine, that one, actually. We'll see.
To develop yourself, to respect the ideas of others, and learn respectful ways of maybe encouraging them to think in other ways as well. Self-respect and respect of others.
Sorry.
To increase self-awareness, sort of knowledge of self. Forgot that?
Okay, forgot that would be.
Yeah. Okay. Is that okay with everyone? Okay, let's see what we've got. What I've got here is my understanding of what, of why we started PIPs. So I'll just relate what I understand is, and Rob and Art can fill in if I leave anything out. And we'll see if it fits in with what's been said here. Okay, the vision. The idea was to do with creating ideal spaces where groups of people could meet and talk about life's big questions, express their thoughts and learn from each other. So the original idea was, and still is, to create a loose network of groups as vehicles for the development of philosophic dialogue, which involves developing the four C's. I think there are six C's, but the four C's we were talking about was critical, creative, collaborative, and caring dialogue, if I'm right. There may be others. So developing understanding of ourselves and the world we inhabit, of our individual social relations, of community, our human, spiritual, aesthetic development. And the dynamic and social nature of the group is an essential part of that, it seems. All this was to a large extent unarticulated, but the idea was, the idea was that it might catch on and roll out across the country, and we'd end up with a more of a reflective thinking culture. That society would become infected with philosophic thinking before the establishment could do anything about it. That last bit is probably something to do with me than the general view to broad church pips, but that's where I, where my motivation is. What do we think of that?
I think one of the things that I think I might have would be to, you know, draw on Socrates' idea of the unexamined life is not worth living. And I think it's important for us as humans with this kind of consciousness to examine our lives and develop a greater sense of, you know, self-awareness in the world. But that's probably the only other thing that I might add.
Okay, thanks, Rob.
I was just going to say that's a very great, to me, democratic ideal. I mean, we think of democracy as being putting hands up, you know, the majority gets it. Really, it's community thinking together, getting clarity. And yeah, okay, the majority win, but if it's simply the majority win, it's not thinking reflective. And it's just ignorance that wins out the day.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there is a really deep motivation that's political. And there's the personal deepening of personal life.
Community thinking, yeah, that's a good idea. It connects to what Victoria was talking about. Not necessarily philosophy, but community thinking, very important part of it.
Yeah, I would think more of influencing the establishment rather than opposing the establishment. Because I think what you said before, the establishment can do anything about it, it's the wrong way. Because really, we should be on the side of the establishment and also to influence them to be more supportive, to be mutually supportive. What we're doing is helping the establishment in having a liberal society.
Yeah, I agree. I recognise the problems with that when I said it. Just where I tend to come from, but that's okay, yeah, you're right. Harris?
Do you think then all soldiers in the world and the people in charge of them studied philosophy as part of the training? Would the wars end fast or would they not start?
I don't think they'd start. Before we get into particulars, I want to keep it general.
Well, I was going to say, a lot of them did, didn't they? They did PPE, a lot of the current sort of, you know, ruling class in this country, in the cabinet and the opposition, did PPE. I don't know where any of the philosophical critical thinking is, because the philosophy, politics and economics. Yeah. So at Oxford, most of them did it at Oxford. Cameron, Osborne, Miliband, numerous.
That is a big assumption that I tend to make, that if we have a more philosophic thinking society, it would be a better society. I believe that's true, but from what's been said, it's not necessarily the case, because lots of people aren't well educated without it.
What you get is a more philosophical society.
Okay, yeah.
That's the idea, right? whether it's better, fairer, ever they're going to win the cup or anything like that, that's neither here nor
there. There's a really fascinating dialogue in which Plato actually discusses this question in the cause of war. And I can't remember actually what it is, but I heard it presented once. But yeah, he's very aware of this. But basically, just greed is the problem. But yeah, you need to think.
Okay. So together then we understand what Pips is about. It seems like we're all singing from the same song sheet, if I can say that. So the next step of this day is to begin to understand, begin to talk about the best way to do that, to bring about this vision, this idea. Okay. So we're going to look at the role of the organiser in the first part of this course before we get on to the facilitation, which is connected to it, but different in lots of ways and much more complicated, I would argue. This part is quite simple, it seems to me, the practical way of setting up a group, starting a group, and the various things you have to do. And then we'll talk about, or Arthur will talk about, the role of the organiser. Okay, can I just say before we get into that discussion, talk about me and Arthur and Varys and Rob have been part of a wider organisation, community philosophy organisation, which grew out of SAPRI. And we've been to various meetings in London. And out of that, an understanding came of what we're doing and how important it is what PIPS is doing in the community philosophy movements. And what we realised is three areas of society where community philosophy happens. They are institutional situations, an institutional area, schools, colleges, universities, prisons, companies, faith groups. Semi-institutional, art galleries, cultural centres, libraries, small businesses, community churches. The non-institutional, public spaces, pubs, cafes, community centres, fairs, stalls on a fair. And it's mainly the last two areas that we work in, with the majority of groups operating in the third area, the open public arena. These categories are useful, if only to point out the difficulties in the semi and non-institutional areas that we operate in. Not that the groups in the operating in the institutions have it that easy. They run up against different types of limitations, organisational structures. It usually amounts to how much time they're allowed to do community philosophy. But they do have captive, if you like, ready-made groups. So whereas the semi-institutional and non-institutional or public sphere groups had to be created from scratch, we have to create them from scratch, but they already have the groups there, you see. So there's no group in the local pub waiting for you to talk about philosophy. You have to create the group from nothing, which is significant, it seems to me, when it comes to promoting philosophy in the community. We're actually creating a group, a community of inquiry, that is part of the community, part of organic part of the community. It's not like being put on people, it grows out of the community. That's the ideal, anyway. So we're starting something that wasn't there. This is something that I've picked up. I don't know what you're at. When we go down to London, and it's and people have all these fantastic jobs and they're applying community philosophy to their workforce, which is great, it's fantastic. But it's not creating newness, and it might get done maybe once or twice in a year. Whereas we create a group, and it meets every week or twice a week or once a month. It's an awful lot more that we're doing in the community, it seems to me. So that's why we're having this training day, to try and talk about that and create more of it.
My name's Arthur Adlin. I've been chair and secretary of the Merseyside Committee previously. I'm organising two groups, one in the Rose and Crown in Bebbington and one in the Casa in Liverpool. The role of the organiser within PIPS is absolutely crucial. We rely on people given the time and efforts and their expertise, you know, day in, day out, really. And it's certainly very much appreciated. And I think picking up on one of the things Paul said, we don't parachute in and start a group and then go and start another one. Although I have, but we stay with the group. So we're part of that group. And while we've got groups all over the place, in, you know, pubs, cafes, community centres, church halls, whatever, ideally, people are going into somewhere local, not necessarily a pub, but somewhere local to them, even if it's in the middle of Liverpool, a central location, somewhere that they know, that they feel they belong to, and they're getting a group growing, as Paul said, from scratch. And I think one of the very impressive things about PIPS is the variety of groups. So groups are all different to each other by virtue of the fact that they're in different places. So like the Rose and Crown is different to the Casa, because the Casa is a trade union-based bar. The Crown in Liverpool is different because it's a centrally located city centre bar, so that's different to some of the others that might be on the outskirts. Groups are also different because of the people that attend, so that they've got their own style and their own approach and that. And I think part of the variety is the approach that the actual organiser gives it, so that their personality can infect the group, hopefully in a good way. And the way that the organiser operates obviously affects the group. Now, the Merseyside Committee drew up a policy on organisers and facilitators, which hopefully people have seen, got them today. Yeah, can do. And it looks a bit heavy, but believe me, these are the jobs that all organisers do. And it looks heavy because we've tried to leave nothing out, because as I say, you know, we recognise the work that goes into it. So I'll just run through it. The seven jobs: maintaining contact with group members, producing future topic schedules, arranging for the distribution of publicity, taking new people's details, providing the secretary, or Paul in this case, with membership and mailing list details, collecting and recording donations, and passing on donations to the treasurer. Now, if we've left anything out, if people can say to us, oh, well, there's another job that you haven't noticed, please tell us. And of course, these jobs can be shared out. They don't have to be done by one person. But we thought it'd be good for us to have some real life experience from one of our organisers. So Dulcie's going to tell us about their experience in setting up their group. Okay. You might have to have this on as well.
I actually thought I got away with it when you were
No.
Hi, everybody. My name is Dulcie, for those that don't know, and I've been going to PIPS groups for roughly, I think, 8 to 10 years. After a while, I decided that I would want one in my own location. And I think for me, that's the most important reason probably for setting up a new group. You realise the importance of the groups that you've been to and the service that they do for the community. And you would like to have that in another area to allow other people in other areas to get to those groups. So I decided to have one near to where I lived. It's been a positive experience from then to now. It isn't as difficult as anybody might think, and I would say that if you think that it's something that you would like to do, please put it into action. You'd be surprised at how welcoming people are. They may have their own agendas, perhaps in pubs and cafes. They need bums on seats and they need revenue as well. But that is working with a group in the community. So I think you would be welcome with open arms. But you've got to find a suitable venue. So the first thing I did was look in my Yellow Pages phone directory, internet, anywhere you want to research it, for all the pubs that were in about half an hour's walking distance from me. But it wasn't about me. So you have to think about how you're going to encourage people to come to the group. And they're going to come if they can access it easily, because they've got lives as well. So you want to take into account things like transport, perhaps. You know, how far are they going to have to walk from a station? How far are they going to have to come by bus? So take that into account as well. Don't try and get somewhere out of the way where people might need vehicles or whatever. Try and make it as accessible as possible. So when I start, once I'd got the names of, say, a lot of venues in my local area, what I then did was made a decision to visit them personally, because I think there's nothing like a personal touch. And if you look into a lot of PIP's documentation, say on the website or anywhere else, it does I don't think that you're sending... we do have leaflets. We have a lot of leaflets, and they're very important to take with you. But I do think that you need the personal touch, because you go down and speak to people. So I would say, yes, phone people if you must. But really, if you can explain more about PIPs and how important it is. And that's what I was going to say about in some, a lot of the documentation. It says that once we are, say, immersed in PIPs or committed, then we are representatives of PIPs. And I think if you can go down and demonstrate the value of PIPs and what will be taken into what essentially is their business, they'll be far more welcoming than they would if they just got a leaflet presented through the post or if they got a phone call. So I would say the personal touch. So I went round and met quite a lot of people who run pubs, clubs, coffee bars or what have you. But also you have to look at the physical side as well. Looked at the seating, looked at the size and whether it was conducive to conversation. As you're looking in public places a lot of the time, it wouldn't really do to be too put off by others being able to hear you. And part of the joy of PIPs is that when you are having a discussion in a public place, then the community take an interest. I don't really think, for me anyway, that you can have or be as open or as in the public eye as in a pub when people can actually see you. We've had lots of people coming over saying, what do you talk about? And, you know, they come over and break, they say, can I just sit and listen for a few minutes? So I think it's vital that it's still in the community and not behind closed doors. So, yeah, I think there's a desire at first, then there is deciding to make it personal, finding a proper venue with seating, making sure it's accessible to people. And the evening is important as well, the evening and the timing. What I like about PIPs is that whatever group you look at will run at a different time of the day. So if you go on the website, there's something for everybody. I chose the evening for selfish reasons, because then I could attend. So I run one, or we run one, I should say, from 7 till 9, because as an organiser, I'd like to just not argue a lot with Arthur, but maybe one point he said, the organiser doesn't have to be all bubbly or singing or dancing. The organiser organises. So I'm just disagreeing slightly. I think it's the facilitator who will carry a meeting well. I think the organiser is very important, but if you look at that list, they are doing sort of like the management jobs. I think it's the facilitator who allows the group to do... I'll leave it to you to talk about that. But I really believe it's the facilitator and how they enable others that will allow the group to develop. I think I've just about covered everything except to say, please don't just think about it. Just actually do it. Because if we don't... if you have that urge to do it and you don't do it, that's the only way we fail. You don't fail if it only goes for a few weeks or a few months. You don't fail if it changes venue. We only fail if we don't try. And because of the good that PIPs does throughout the community, I really think we should all try. I think I would just, I'll finish right away for fear of repeating myself, but if there's anything anybody wanted to ask me, because I'm not aware of what I've left out.
Just a quick question. Can I just say, if you're trying to set something up initially then, it just strikes me that it would be quite difficult to separate out the roles of organiser and facilitator. If the person who's fired up to actually start, probably at the beginning, would do both roles until somebody else could take on one of them. Do you know what I mean?
Thanks. Arthur may speak about that. Sorry, what's your name, please?
Rob.
Hi, Rob. I think that's a very important point, because at first it may very well be all down to you. And that's vital, thanks, because it's great to have an oppo. If I'm busy one night, I'm very lucky in that I'm supported by a couple of people who've belonged to PIPs for years. And I will say, I won't be there this week. Will you please collect the money and give it to me next week? Because we collect subs as well. You may be facilitating a lot when you first begin. And it does say that in a lot of the documentation. But it's vital to have other people on board with you, because it's so, the groups are sort of generic. They grow from what we begin. I think organisers should always stay away from the danger of believing that they own the group. That's vital, because the group is really run by the group and a lot of decisions are made by the group. But very important for me, I think I need to stress as well, was the support that I didn't expect, to be honest, but it just came from people who already were organising PIPs. They knew I was trying to get a group off the ground. I'd asked two people who I knew who would come. But on that night, it was just absolutely fabulous to see the support of Paul and others who had got the idea that a group was started. And they just descended and made sure that there were people there for a discussion to go ahead. I'm not saying they can do it all the time, but they do it wherever they can, you know, without any hesitation.
When you started your group, you did it in part because you wanted to get into the talking room. But getting into the talking of a group is terribly different from being a facilitator, because the great gift of a facilitator is to enable other people to include it. You've got to pay attention to that. When the moment you get caught up in talking, you get caught up in the drama of the ideas as they're flashing. And they're two very, very different things. One is a real, and to me, my problem is I get caught up in conversation, I become completely unaware of the relationships. But you need that person who is really aware of what's going on. But so the gift of the organizer is very different from the gift of the facilitator. They're very two different tasks too. And two, of course, obviously very, very important. So if you try to do both, you'll probably get burned out, I think. Is that true?
I'll agree with what you say, Stephen. I hope I didn't make out that I was there just to talk, because part of the thing that I like, what I like most of all is listening to the ideas of others. If you want to talk, you can be on your own, use a mirror, but you go to, for me, I go to philosophy and pubs to listen, because if I don't listen, and like you say, if I don't give the other three rein, which I believe is part of the facilitator's role as well, not the organisers, then, yeah, I wouldn't develop.
At all. So I agree with you, they're two very separate roles.
Yeah, I mean, just, but one is getting caught up in the drama, it's another has got to manage the drama from the sides, because one of the troubles is it can get overwhelmed.
I agree with you totally, but I think at that point it's going to be taken up in the role of facilitator. Really, I'm just sharing my experience of setting up, which has been positive the whole way. Sorry, can I see that?
Yeah.
Dan.
Hi, Dan. Hi, Dan. Hi, peace to meet you. Yeah, you hit the nail on the head, actually. I think basically just taking a bit of a general overview of the what is available, the venues of the places, I think they cause for more venues to be created in the town centre, that a lot of them aren't particularly accessible. The place in Waterloo, speaking for myself, I come from St Helens, and I've taken bus then to Waterloo, you know, you may have Ormskirk. Mm. I think really speaking, we should keep them more centralised in the town centre, you know, has more pubs. Access more pubs in the town centre.
I think that's going to be something that will be down to the individual. You know, it's wherever you can get to and where you perceive a need as well, because not everybody can travel into the city centre, but I think it's a valid point. There are more places in the city centre.
It could be developed,
and what we need is people who will jump up and organise a group and actually start a group, yeah.
Yeah, but I'm bearing out what you're saying, that it is, aren't too centralised, so therefore they need to be centralised, therefore we need to take the initiative and get them in the town centre rather than Ormskirk or whatever.
I'm going to agree with you, but because it is central, people can all come in on the bus or on the train, by car. They would be centralised, but there is also a need for places on, the outskirts of cities in towns, for people like Ormskirk. I'm sure they're Lancashire-based, and if any of them haven't got transport, they would like one that is within reach for them. I agree that centralised is easier for the majority of people, but I would say don't let that put you off starting a group anywhere where there isn't one at all.
Victoria?
I'm operating in a rural, semi-rural community.
Yeah.
And
And I think, you know, although I was brought up in Ormskirk, so I hope that gives me some local credibility. But it's not really, that's not really, if you've got a, it depends on the critical mass, and it depends on what you're looking for in terms of a group. And it strikes me, listening to what's going on, that you're used to fairly regular groups. And what helps for us is that we don't know who's going to turn up. And although there are regulars, it's the debate itself, it's what the topic of the, is what attracts. So on my network, I hope this is useful, on my network of people who receive email information, there are 320 people. But of that, probably 12 to 20 will turn up. But it's not always the same. So I personally think that if you've got a venue that people know about, they'll get there. So I don't think it has to be an urban thing. I'm just putting that in the plot. It doesn't need to be urban.
I think when you choose a venue, you have to sort of take into account what's likely to happen, because I go to quite a lot of philosophy groups, and I find the ones that are better, you don't let, not so, I know it's called philosophy in pubs, but maybe philosophy in cafes are a little bit of an easier option, because you can hear better, and there's some pubs that are ideal, like the Crown, we go upstairs, so. But I think that it can be drowned by, you know, other things that are going on in the pub. So I think that is quite an important thing to take into account. I also think that, I know that when you're in the community, people can see you, but I've introduced a few people to philosophy because I like it so much, and I tell everybody about it, and then they tell other people. I think that's a good way of spreading the news as well.
Word mouth is brilliant. Thanks for making
that. And I really promote it in a very positive way, you know, because I think it's fantastic.
Thanks, Maureen, because I didn't mention as well, taking along a lot of the literature, did I, when you go to the groups or to pass out every single week or even to people. I agree with you, and it's already been noted, I think, for quite a while, because if you go on the website, there is good general information there about setting up a group, and it says that although we're called philosophy of pubs, it doesn't necessarily have to be a pub, it can be any venue. So that has been recognised. It's just that that's where it started, and that's the name that's stuck so far.
Yes.
Hi, Russell.
Yes, I agree with that lady who spoke previously. There is a conflict here, because ideally we want to be in the community, but then we have the problems with noise and things like that. So on one side you could have problems with too much noise, but somewhere like the Crown, I found anyone outside the group couldn't hear what was going on. So in that way it's more an isolation when you go upstairs. In that sense you're separating yourself from the community. So it's maybe hard to think of a good compromise or balance between the two.
I don't know if anybody, it is a conflict, but at the same time we are people who meet in public places, aren't we? So we go with the public place we can get, but it sounds like a conflict, but yeah, no promises. Unless there's anything else,
I think Arthur's going to cover some
Yeah, okay, thank you. Thanks, Paul.